Right, me and Brian are back in the Porterhouse. Today we're going to talk about stouts. Let's go inside. Holy crap. This suddenly reminds me of the scene from Alien. I think it's the second one, you know, where all the pots are like inside the building and there's just everywhere, yeah, about to open. So this, for some reason, just reminded me of that straight away. Wow, okay. I've never been here.
No?
Not this part.
These are barrels of beer.
Kegs.
Kegs. Plastic. Steel. Casks. This is a keg of plain porter. There's 88 pints of beer in that.
Yep. You don't want to drop on that, your toes.
Oh, you completely destroy your foot.
Yeah, a friend of mine did that once.
I work with barmen who've lost the tops of their fingers from taking this off.
Wow.
Yeah. There's a lot of gas pressure that goes into these.
Yeah, of course.
So turn them off.
So, how does this work? Do we have, we obviously have one here. Which one is?
These are the stouts here.
Yeah.
So, for example, Rumpole's, where we're sitting. Inside this barrel, this is a nut. And attached to this, what's called a spear, the long tube goes down. The bottom of the barrel.
Yep.
So don't fear them, I'm not thinking that's the bottom of the barrel.
Every pint comes from the bottom of the barrel. Every pint.
Gotcha.
Comes from the bottom of the barrel. So, here's your beer. Here's your gas. Stouts would be used as nitrogen. I'll show you the nitrogen where it comes from inside the other room. The nitrogen, under pressure, was in there, was down there. Down the spear, puts the beer under pressure and pushes the beer up through that tube that's inside here and it comes out of this and then you follow it all the way along and it goes up into this. This is your cellar boy. The point of this essentially is, you can see it better on these fellas, this little plastic fella that's here. When the beer empties, that'll fall down and block it off so the gas then doesn't get into the line.
Gotcha, yeah.
So when the beer barrel finishes, that drops down, then you just put on a new one, and away you go.
Cool.
It's it looks more complicated than it is, frankly.
What's the temperature here?
In this room, currently it's 7 degrees. Ideally, it'll be 6.
Yeah.
This hard-working Trojan of a unit here has been pumping out cold air into this room for donkey's years.
Yeah, well, in all fairness, I think I prefer stouts. I prefer them a little bit warmer than.
Ideally,
so,
yes.
So I think I'm happy with 7 today.
Oh yeah.
Cool. Right, where we go next?
Pull that door too. All of that gets powered by this. This is your gas unit.
Okay.
Nitrogen, CO2. CO2 is your fizzy stuff, your lagers, and the hophead and whatnot. And the nitrogen to your stouts. And then there's also, this is why you have the hammer in your hand, JP. This is where we keep all of our hopper beers.
Oh, wow.
In our cold room. This is a refrigerated room. Well,
I can feel it. This feels colder than the other one.
Wouldn't have been stocked up today, you see, so that door has not really been opened all day.
Cool. Perfect.
We want to do. Yeah, we need to do dungeons. This room down here is called the brewery.
Okay.
Because we used to make beer down here.
Oh yeah.
This essentially now is, used to be a keg slide there as well. The kegs all just come horsing down there, dragged up through. This would be a lift. Directly underneath the front door.
Yeah, I was saying
that. Kegs come down, store, and away.
Safer way of doing it.
Yeah, the old way of just literally rolling it down that That's no bueno. Lots of science.
Cool. That's basically the basement, isn't it?
Essentially, that's the pit, the cellar. That's the hole where Starbucks got to die.
That's the lines going
that's
up,
sir. Line.
Yeah. Wow.
That'll go up. That will go up to the main bank of taps. It's coming out of here. And it's going all the way down and then up to the main bank of taps. And that will hold 3.5 pints.
Yeah, they got new lines here, didn't they, a few years back?
Oh, every 7 or 8 years.
But they got more better. More modern lines, I think. There was something about that, but there were less. There's less beer in the line itself.
Yeah, they're really, really thin.
Yeah, yeah.
Really, really thin lines. And that's in this. Well, these teams are basically much bigger. Yeah. In the way, you know. That's the Hampton and Rumpel's where shit gets dropped down the whole.
Oh yeah.
Everyone's seen that.
Cool.
There is there's very little to say on the process of pouring beer. This is a tap, and here's your glass. See how big my hands are when I hold this pint glass? So we opened the tap, and we saw the beer. We saw the python, in fact, down below us here.
Yeah.
And it just comes out. Pouring beer is not difficult. I'll do it again, if you weren't watching. Tap, glass. The Wrasslers is down here.
Follow it.
Many, many, many years ago, when your bar would have the stouts, we used to have them here, in fact, and you'd have your barrels of beer behind the bar. You would have the newer beer and then slightly older beer. So what you would do is you would fill up your pint with your older beer, a little bit there, let it all settle down a bit, and then you would top it up with the newer beer. So. When this nitrogenated system was first introduced for pouring stouts and lagers, you'd have people would still want the two-part pour. So they would pour your stouts to there and then top it up. And if you don't, if you pour it straight to the top of hand, it's, oh, that's going to make me sick, I can't drink that. It doesn't make a difference. It's just beer. You can quite comfortably pour it straight to the top. And it won't make any difference to the beer at all. At all, at all. It's just habit that I'm after doing it like that. These beers are also available in bottles.
Yeah, I haven't.
Maurice?
Which you can also get as a takeaway. Right, so we're back in the Temple Bar. We're back in the Porterhouse in the Temple Bar area. Today we are talking about stouts, and any beer lover has got to get a little bit excited about stouts, in all fairness, don't they?
It's a wonderful category.
It is, and it's one that the Porterhouse does extremely well.
Our best beers are our stouts. Our stouts are our best beers.
But before we dig in, I want to say a quick thing about the sample trays, which you can get in the Porterhouse. So a lot of people come in here, they don't know there's so many big selection of beer all the Porterhouse beers, you can sample them on a sample trace, which is pretty much exactly the same price than your first pint would be anyway.
And this, each glass is a third of a pint.
Yeah, so it takes the same amount of alcohol, and you can mix and match whatever of their own beers. It's a great way to get a kind of quick introduction to some of the beers.
Mm. And these paddles also, Valentine's weekend, we sell them in black leather.
Excellent. Right, so let's get into the stouts.
We have four currently. Is the sun going in? Not quite yet.
That's fine.
We have four. We have the first one we're going to try today is the plain porter. That would be technically a Dublin dry stout. It's the lightest of the four stouts that we brew. And you'll notice on the bottom of the little card thing,
awards.
And the World Brewing Awards, International World Brewing Awards, Beer Oscars in Burton and Trent every 2 years. In 1998 and 2001, this beer, the plain porter, won the gold medal. Best beer in class. So Guinness would be your Dublin dry stout, would be the most readily known, commercially produced, mass produced, should I say.
Yeah.
Made by factories, blah, blah, blah. Where's the Porterhouse?
Made by men, not machines.
Is that on the back of this?
No, it's not, but I remember that.
Oh,
I look at you all the time and stuff.
Yeah, okay. I might have it on my shirt. Anyway, so you're plain porter.
Yeah.
We mentioned hops and grains last week, and in fact, and it's written on the back of the cards as well. Grains, pale malt, which would be your base malt you'd use for beer. Flaked barley.
Yeah.
It has more surface area. So it gets involved a lot more. Roasted barley brings out the colour. That's where your colour in your stouts come from. And a black malt. Black malt just gives it a bit of body.
Yeah.
You know. And crystal malt, again, it's just part of it. And then the hops are Galena, Nugget and East Kent Goldings.
Yeah.
They would all be much older stouts. So the older English ones. There's nothing particularly amazing or groundbreaking about this beer other than the fact that it's just a brilliant example of a porter. It's a gorgeous beer. And these little glasses as well.
Oh, memories.
Perfect.
Memories. You know, about 2 years of drinking any of this. Straight away, the one big difference between, like, if you're used to drinking Guinness, is that this one, you can actually taste hops, and you can definitely taste the malt.
You taste everything.
Yeah, there's genuine points of flavour, whereas Guinness can be
designed by committee to be flavourless.
Yeah, it'd be bland side, unfortunately.
Yeah, you can drink loads of stuff, and it's
same strength.
Same everything, but it tastes like beer. It's silky.
Yeah, exactly. And there's things going on here. Like, it's not just.
Yeah.
By the way, sorry about the light today. It's the sun is out, which we're not used to it in Ireland.
Well, no, that's why I'm wearing the pig hooded top. No, it won't last.
Exactly.
It's not going to last. It'll be gone in half an hour.
So yeah, exactly. So enjoy seeing us on a very brightly lit, sunny scene, which is very difficult to film. But hey, we're doing okay.
We much prefer drinking in the dark, you see, in this country. It's a traditional way to drink.
Oh my god, that's good. I forgot how good that is.
It's perfect. It's light. It's got body.
Do you know, there's a part of me that didn't want it to be this good.
Because you didn't want to end up having to drink it for the rest
exactly.
of your life.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's a little bit sweet.
Damn it.
But there's a good, strong, beery bitterness at the finish of it. Not even as strong, but it's there.
Yeah. That's the thing. It's not strong bitterness, but it's very much is there, and it's very. I come from a different background. I come from a Scandinavian country where our beer was for generations made by
Scandinavia.
Finland.
Finland's not part of Scandinavia, JP.
But where our beer was made by the government licensed companies, and it was all pretty much bland. One type beer. Now Finland is going through an amazing microbrewery boom as well. There's beer everywhere. So when I first got into stouts, which was Guinness, the first problem would have been the lack of good quality Guinness in Finland. So then I got into Ireland and realized that, okay, this is a good Guinness. There was a certain kind of process of getting used to the flavors of it. I'd say for anybody who's used to drinking Guinness to go into this, it would be the same thing. There would be a process. I've seen some really hardcore Guinness drinkers resisting it to the last they could and eventually being turned into plain drinkers. Which is like, I'm not getting into it, a lot of people are exactly like that because they're so used to drinking the flavors of the Guinness.
Yes.
And it's something that you associate with, like, I really enjoy this. So
people equate the brand name Guinness with a style of beer. Do you have any? Do you have a Guinness? We don't sell Guinness. But what's that? Oh, that's a plain porter. Oh, give us a pint of your plain Guinness. It's your Guinness substitute. That gets my goat, man. I hear
now. This is
your
this
Guinness
is
substitute. Yeah, you don't drink my Guinness. What kind of a bleeding pub doesn't sell Guinness?
I'll tell you what kind of a bleeding pub doesn't sell Guinness. Anyway, I won't go into that.
I'm just going to enjoy it.
it does me head in. At least once a month, a grown man would say to you, over the bar, oh, we don't sell Guinness, mate. What do you mean you don't sell Guinness? Mm. Sure, it's a pub, isn't it? Give us a pint of Guinness here, no problem. Come on, pop. We don't sell Guinness. Don't get cheeky with me, son. What's he drinking? I don't know what he's drinking. It's a stout, too. Oh, give us a pint of Guinness here. And you give him the pint of plain, and you get him occasionally going, God, that's a good pint of Guinness. A good pint of Guinness that good in 30 years. Or else, oh man, your Guinness tastes off. There's something wrong with your pint of Guinness. Stouts and porters, there's more to it though.
Yeah.
There's more to it than just porter. For example, we also produce an oyster stout.
A lot of people get excited about this one, and I'm actually quite excited.
Well, yeah, a lot of the beer nerds do, because it's
different.
It's a style of beer that's out there, but, I mean, nobody makes an oyster stout.
Yeah.
You know? Literally nobody makes oyster stouts.
Except the Porterhouse for the past, 20
well,
years?
Yeah, we've been making it all the time. Yeah. Marston's in the UK make one.
You said you read a little bit about the history of the...
Yeah, I was very surprised.
So there's actually quite a lot of long tradition of oyster stouts.
Well, there isn't, in fact. That's the weird thing about it. Again, you look at this, it's entirely the same malts and the same hops.
Oh, is it? Okay.
But there would be oysters gone into the beer.
So talk us through the process of the oysters.
In the 1800s, stouts are essentially an English produce. They were always an English beer. They become famous here because of the large corporate brewers up the river.
Yeah.
So in the 1800s, there is documentation of men would eat oysters, eating shellfish, whilst drinking the local beer, which would be a stout. You know, and the guy would, you know, all the beer would be made locally, so. They would need finding ways to filter out the beer to take away any sediment in it. So what I used to do was they'd sweep all the shells up off the floor and you'd pour your beer over. What came out the other side of it would be a clearer beer. The shell of these would calcium carbonate, lots of carbonates, which would be positively charged ions, and all of the sediment in the beer is negatively charged, blah, blah, blah.
Folly,
and it would clear up the beer. And then what later on brewers would end up would put the shells into the beer, because then that would fall down through the beer to the bottom of the tank, and it would take all the sediment with it, and then you can empty the tank from the top, easy peasy. And then now I don't know about although I did read up on this last night. And apparently the story goes that in 1928 in New Zealand, a brewer, maybe by accident or maybe just thought, well, sure, we'll give it a go. He threw the whole oysters into the tank, into where the beer's boiling, meat and everything. And what you've come out with is an oyster stout. Whereas an oyster stout used to be just a name for a session stout.
Yeah.
Where it had to be sitting around drinking loads of it all day and eating the things, and became an oyster stout. An oyster stout now is essentially a stout with oysters in it. The oldest recipe I've found for it would have oysters in it and would use a thing called Irish moss to filter the beer. Irish moss is a form of seaweed.
Yeah.
Really cute. Stereotype seaweed. Boil it, you treat it with a certain chemical, and then you introduce it to the beer and it works the filtration system. The problem was though, or the problem is that according to the EU regulations and all these things, everything has to be classified and named. And that particular seaweed is classified as E401. So you don't want to be saying, you know, we use the E numbers in our beer, because people would be equating that dash are the same as other generic multi international brewers.
That's mad.
So the Irish moss is not really used anymore with the filtration of this beer. Many brewers will still use filings of some description or isinglass, which is the bladders from fish.
So this beer is definitely not for vegans.
This beer is, neither of these two beers are suitable for vegans.
Oh really?
Yes.
The Wrasslers as well?
Yeah, the filtration system.
Plain's fine for vegans.
Plain's fine for vegetarians.
Vegetarians.
It's just beer.
Don't tell me that we didn't offer you an option.
Yes. Now this one.
You know exactly where that's going to go.
Very different. This one is very different.
The Oyster Stout.
This is the Oyster Stout. It's a peculiar thing.
Oh wow. I haven't had one of these in a long time.
Damn it, I said the same thing last night.
Yeah, you did.
I haven't drank it in a long time, and I thought to myself, oh, there's a great finish on that beer. Right then at the very, very end of it, there's a lovely... Yeah.
It's like a soft complexity. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
The softness carries the flavour, and it's like... Like, look, if you're a beer nerd, you're going to have to try this somewhere along your life. Simple as, because it is a unique beer.
Yes.
It's not a gimmick. It's actually damn good beer.
It's very good beer.
Yeah.
It's not a gimmick at all.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. But very often you would assume that because of the name of it, you know.
There's oysters in it.
Yeah, exactly.
What does that mean? Okay. I don't even know fish and chips.
Yes. That's gorgeous.
That's very nice.
That has, there's a lot of flavour in that. Again, you said about, it's very subtle. There is a sweetness. It would be a naturally sweeter stout.
Yeah.
I don't know, depending on the audience here, you'd mentioned that people would ask you for pints of Beamish other than Guinness.
Mm-hmm.
Beamish was always...
I like Beamish.
Beamish is always a little bit sweeter than Guinness.
I think Beamish is... compared to Guinness, like, if that's the two options, it always is a little bit more flavour.
A little bit more flavour. Tastier beer. Yeah, it's good gear. I guess I'm not saying this tastes like Beamish, I'm saying it is a little bit sweeter.
Yeah.
The way Beamish, I'd imagine it still is, I haven't seen Beamish in a long time.
I'm not a food place.
I'm sure there are. That's Phil said it. So, what think you of Oyster Stout?
It's still surprisingly light in flavour. Like, there's a lot of complexity, but when you drink it, it's not heavy.
Yes, none of the flavor points meet. They don't spike. It's a wonderfully rounded flavor.
Yeah. The balance is kind of, it's like a really subtle, the flavors are subtle, but there's lots of them.
And again, they're all, it's big and quite rounded, but light as well. The Plain's 4.2% and the Oyster Stout here, it was 4.6.
Mm-hmm.
4.6.
Yeah.
When the Plain won its second gold medal in 2008, the first runner up was the Marsden's Oyster Stout, which, according to my very limited research, it has to be said, is the only other oyster stout available on this side of the Atlantic.
Where is it?
Marsden's is in the UK, somewhere up north, I think. There are a couple of the American brewers make oyster stouts. But there's no oysters in it.
Yeah.
they just called them Oyster Stout. And of course, being American stouts, they're all between 6 and 9%.
Yeah,
you know,
the heavier stuff. Like,
full on, and I'm sure they're massively hopped in there.
Yeah.
Loads of everything. It's a huge beer.
It's a very different style.
Very different drinking.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, at the risk of pandering to stereotypes, the American will do his drinking over 2 hours. And he'll be done. He'll drink 6-7 strong beers. Whereas an Irishman, he'd rather drink over 6 hours.
Irishman starts on Monday and finishes on Sunday.
Or there's some people that I know who start on the Sunday morning and end on Sunday night. And that's all the way around. Or like me, I started in about 1980.
Started on the 1st of January, finished on the
31st of December. Have a few hours kip and carry on.
Now obviously we condemn that kind of behaviour.
Well,
don't,
obviously,
don't
yeah, drink sensibly, drink sensibly, drink responsibly is what they say, you know. I think we don't mind that nonsense. Drink as much as you can, drink as often as you want. You know, you're going to die eventually, alone, in the dark. So you enjoy your time here. There's a cheer for Buddy. That's it. Sun's gone in now, that's it.
Yep,
yep. That's it. I get all my superpowers from the sun.
I'm actually quite excited about the last one. There's a bit of history here. Rasslers.
There's a lot of history. Well, Stout is a, I suppose, it's a reasonably historic form of beer.
You know, Ireland kind of adopted it in a lot of ways.
Well, Arthur Guinness brought it over here and he started doing it. Porter.
Which, by the way, not that we're going to dwell on too much on Guinness, but having said that, like, when it happened, which I believe it was a very different pint back then than it is now, but when it happened, it was a groundbreaking. Like, there was nobody else making stouts in Ireland, and everybody thought that he was a fool.
Yeah.
Like, everybody thought that he was an idiot.
Oh, what are you doing? Yeah,
How is this going to work? Like, which is exactly the same thing that happened in 1996 when
the Porterhouse
was opened by Liam Oliver.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Everybody was saying that not a hope that a pub in Temple Bar without Guinness would last.
A pub without Guinness?
Yeah, 21 years later, here we are.
And here we are. And we still don't sell the stuff.
Yeah, no.
There's no need to.
Exactly. No, and it, far from struggling, you know.
Far from struggling. Yeah. This pub never stops. It's always busy.
It's massive.
It's quiet today because
it's quality.
The whole country is girding his loins and holding its breath for St. Patrick's fortnight, which is coming up.
Yeah, but the time this comes up, we're only probably less than a week away from St. Patrick's Day. Quite a week away from St. Patrick's Day.
It's next
which
Friday.
Which is why we are, for the week. Which is why we are reviewing the stouts as an kind of alternative to the go-to stout. So.
Yes, to.
I think we said enough about them.
There's enough said about them.
So let's concentrate on the good stuff.
I wanted to say, when they were brewing the beer, this would be in London, and they would brew the beer and it would be shipped down to the river. It would be carried down to the river to be sent off points east and west. And the chaps that would bring the beer from the brewery down to the river, they're not going to pay them in cash. They pay them in beer, small beer, the lighter beer. And the lads used to carry the beer down from the brewery to the river would be called the porters. So the lightest of the beers that they would make in the brewery would be the porter, would be called the porter, given to these chaps. And that's the name, that's what porter is, its name is the lighter of the stouts. The other end of the scale is a Russian imperial stout, which was first brewed for the Tsar of Russia. Came over to London and liked the beer, wanted it stronger. So one of the English brewers, the London brewers, he made a stronger beer again. Stout, the same style, loads of everything, loads and shifted across. It was a super strong, thick, heavy beer that the Prince of Russia loved. It was an enormous, enormous man.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a huge monster of a man and he wanted strong beer. And that became known as the Russian Imperial Stout. And the classifications of stouts and porters, it's the same as any style of beer.
Yeah.
You know, we've touched on black Imperial IPAs and all that kind of jazz. And it's been brewed all over the place by many different people. Stouts being synonymous with Ireland, really, because of the efforts of Guinness up the river here. Produce a lot of beer, and they've really insinuated themselves in the culture of this country in every way. In the 1800s again, this beer was being made in Clonakilty, of all places, by Germans, in a place called Deasy's. It's a pub in Clonakilty.
Yeah.
I actually had this discussion with a chap last night, who said, no. He says, your man there, that's Michael Collins. He was banging on about how Michael Collins only drank the Clonakilty Red. I said to your man, well, he only drank the one beer.
But that's what that's the story I heard.
I said, well, the story that I've heard, the great Austin Clark, who was a very famous poet in this country, going back a long time, his son, Dardis Clark, would have been a very famous historian. And he was rooting around about Clonakilty, which is in Cork, looking for any stories about Michael Collins. And he found, in a shed attached beside the pub, Deasy's pub, where he would have drank his beer, a recipe for this particular beer. And he gave it to us. So this is the Wrasslers Stout. You will notice, or you mightn't even be able to see it now, but the colour of the head on this,
it's much darker.
Is much darker than the other two. You probably can't even see that.
Yeah, there's definitely like a much more a browner.
Oh yeah. This is a much heavier beer. As I describe it occasionally, when I'm in my more flippant moods, when people ask me what's the Wrasslers like, I'll say it's like my first wife. Strangely satisfying, but dark, bitter, dirty, heavy, full on, a dirty head.
No comment.
No comment. Anyway, cheers, JP.
Wrasslers.
Wrasslers Stout.
4X Stout. Now that's what I was waiting for. Here we're talking straight away about, like, the hops are going to come and talk to you straight away. There's bitterness there. There's, as I like to talk about the messing around with the tongue and going around, it straight away goes, swirls around your mouth.
Oh, that's super nice.
There's so much good things going on there.
You do really have to have an open mind.
Yeah.
If you base all...
That's a real beer, lover's beer. Like, that's...
It's a gorgeous
Because
beer.
When you get used to drinking this kind of beers, you want to taste the hops. And this one, here's the stout that... There you go, there's the hops. No hiding there.
No, there's not.
Like, that's...
It's full on. It's not intrusive, it's not in your face, but it's undeniable.
It's very, very balanced again. Yeah. It lingers on.
It's gorgeous. That's the that's the one. If you're going to have 8 points, you have 8 points of playing Happily Days. You're going to have two or three, maybe even four. The Wrasslers is the one for you.
Yeah, that's... I'm actually surprised that I said this now, but this is the one I was looking for the most. But I didn't expect to... Out of the three, it's my favourite, I think.
The gas thing is, anyone with an open mind on beer drinking, which has to be pointed out because we do get a lot of... you know, people only drank Guinness for years, like we mentioned earlier on. And they try to play and go, oh, there's an aftertaste and I don't like that. And then the oyster, I'm not thinking that. There's fish in it. Gives them these other Wrasslers and that's just gone off. That's not right. And yet, if you ask anyone with an open mind and people willing to try anything, most people will end up going back to this. Not most people. A lot of people go back to it and be like, wow. You know, and they'd have another, they keep going back to it because, oh God. Because it comes across this huge beer. When it goes away, it goes away nicely.
Yeah, and yeah, you do, it leaves you craving for more. It does, you got to wonder.
It's very Moorish.
Like, I'm going to go like.
It's very Moorish.
There's another sip there.
God bless him, the great Michael Jackson, who introduced the world to beer. He was a beer writer.
Yeah.
He introduced the world to beer, essentially.
It's confusion with the King of Pop.
Not the guy who invented the moonwalk.
Yeah. the other Michael Jackson.
Different guy.
He's in a different circuit. He's equally famous.
Oh, equally. Loved this beer. He absolutely loved this beer. And rightly so. It's a super, super beer. It is everything you want in a glass of beer. Of course, you know, it's a dark, mysterious beer. And if you drink enough pints of it, you're going to get these little brown lines and just on there. And it will make the colour of your beard look completely different after a while, because you're going to get it on your face drinking of a pint glass. That's why you look at owl lads and they have the nicotine stained beard and all that. Owl lads with their multicoloured beards. Yeah, there's so much more to beer than lagers and IPAs.
I know Porterhouse also seasonally do the chocolate truffle stuff, but there's definitely aroma of chocolate in this one as well. Smell.
It will have those flavours of burnt coffee, roasted coffee, dark chocolate, heavy chocolate, a lot of that kind of stuff. Pints of Wrasslers. And the chap Dardeth Clark we mentioned earlier on, in two of our sites, in this one and in Central, when you walk in the door, there's a photograph of him inside the door. He was a good gent. He was a top man.
He was a
gas man. Bit mad, but you know, aren't we all a little bit mad in our own ways? And he died 4 years ago, and he gave us the Wrasslers. And he'd come in twice a week, he'd get his pint of Wrasslers, sit in the corner with all the newspapers. He'd read every word of it, 3 or 4 pints. And because he gave us the beer, we never once charged him for a pint of Wrasslers. He never paid for it. What he used to do was he'd come up to the bar and he'd give you the old. And you'd come over to him, you'd give him his pint. And he'd sneak you a bar of chocolate. Brilliant. Gas man, a real character. He'd sneak you the bar of chocolate, the leather hat and the leather jacket that he always wore, regardless of the weather outside.
Big beard. Big beard.
Yeah. Big beard. Never once shaved in his life.
Did he?
Never once. That beard was never once touched. Yeah, he's a good egg with Darius. Yeah.
That is a pretty epic start to the Stouts. An epic start to the Irish Stouts. I think we're going to leave it at that.
Bloody hell.
And I think if you guys got any questions, as always, leave them in the comments. We'll try to do our best to answer them. Don't forget to subscribe and turn on your notifications. And we're going to continue next week with more Irish beers. We haven't decided yet. I've got a feeling it's going to be cask ales. But we also, we might... We'll work on that. There might be some other ideas happening as well. So we'll see.
Paddy's Day is coming up next week, boys and girls. So if you're in Dublin and you are drinking,
no better place.
Oh, entirely. The best place to do Paddy's Day.
We'll be here all day.
All week.
So if you want to come and say hello to us.
But say briefly, because we're going to be busy.
No, but I mean, if somebody comes and said, listen, I've been watching your beer vlogs. I'm sure you have a minute to talk to them.
Yes, maybe not a minute. But what I would say is, over the next 10 days, go easy on the floor staff and go easy on the bar staff, because it's busy.
Yeah. They work very, very hard.
Everybody has to, even I have to work hard.
Brilliant. Right. Let's leave it at that. That's awesome.
I mean, you look the size of me. That's why I'm so obesely fat. The amount of beer I consume is just obscene. Yeah, I don't know.